Welcome to Gateway of Hope Church, where we believe in connecting real people to a real God in a real way. You're about to watch a power-packed video of one of our worship services here at Gateway of Hope. We pray it'll be a blessing to you. So come on, grab your Bible and prepare your heart, for you are about to be taught the infallible and perfect and complete Word of God.
Is this name? He comes with his warrior name. holiday season, as Christmas season we're coming into, I would encourage you to be mindful of those around you, those that are in need.
Yes.
You know, when you're at the store, you don't know what that person in front of you or behind you is going through. You don't know what they may be sacrificing to get that toy for their child. Or to even just put a Christmas dinner on the table.
Yes.
We have some in our in our body that's literally called to be out and about like that, and just ministry to people out and about like that. But I think we all can be mindful of those situations and those times when the Lord may just put that little prompt in your heart and in your spirit to give a word of encouragement.
Yeah. lot of praise because they've been delivered from a lot of things. Let me tell you, I don't know where you are today. I know where I was. Bless the Lord, my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. And forget not. Forget not. Forget not all His benefits. He didn't forgive just some of it, but when he went on Calvary, after he had been beaten and a crown of thorns placed on his head, that little baby that we're about to sing all about, when he went to Calvary, he said, "It is done. It's finished. All my iniquities be erased." You may be dragging some iniquities around. Let me tell you, if today you'll just lift a hand and say, "My God, you're awesome. Forgive me." Give you all of your iniquities. And then, then he healed all my diseases. He healed flu. He healed cancer. He healed leukemia. He healed rheumatoid arthritis. He healed liver disease. He healed depression. He delivered whatever you think is not a thing. Thank you.
blood covered you and made a way, Pastor Spence, for you to come in. And you were reconciled to God. You became part. You're at the banqueting table now as His God. Reconciliation, Michelle, has happened. Reconciliation has happened, and you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. But as we go through this life, and as we're buffeted through this life, there's times where we need the restoration of our soul to merge with our spirit. That we need to receive the restoration that God has already provided. It's not a matter of salvation, because if you're in Christ, you're already in Christ. The restoration happens as we worship at the throne of God, as we worship at His feet. And He says, child, I've seen your long day. I've seen your long week. I'm going to restore you now into a place of joy. I'm going to restore you now into a place of strength. It's not about religion. It's not about how much you prayed today or if you read your Bible. It's about the attitude of your heart this morning towards the Father, towards the one that loves you. So Kendrick's going to sing that again and just receive that, because there's healing in your soul. Some of you are saying, my spirit knows you, but my soul, my mind, my will, and my emotions, I'm dry and I'm tired and I feel distant. But yet I know in my spirit man who I am. So there's a restoration that comes as Kendrick started to sing that, a restoring of the soul. As Pastor Spence has been talking about, in the valley of weeping, we find our place. In the valley of Baca, Psalm 84 says, it's a place of weeping, but there's restoration and there's reconciliation at the throne of God. So I just want to find that melody if you can and sing it one more time and just take it into yourself. Where are you today? To say, Lord, whatever needs to be restored in my heart this morning. And it's okay to say, I need more of you, God, even though we have all of Him in our humanness. We just need more. Amen.
And I worship at her So far this morning, and before you walk out of this door this morning, that you will leave transformed and changed by the power of God. By the power of God. Oh, He's good. Come on, say, You're good, Lord. You're good. You're good, Jesus. Lord of Heaven's armies. I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter into the courts of the Lord. With my whole being, my body, and my soul, I will shout joyfully to the living God. For even a sparrow finds a home, and a swallow builds her nest, and raises her young in a place near your altar. O Lord of Heaven's armies, my King and my God, what joy for those who live in your house, always singing your praise. What joy for those whose strength comes from the Lord, who set their mind on a pilgrimage to the holy place. For when they walk through the valley of weeping, it will become a place of refreshing springs. The autumn rains will clothe it with blessing. This morning there's some folks walking through the valley of weeping today. And we're going to believe the Lord in this house today to transform those valleys, according to the scripture that this church is founded upon, the valley of trouble into a gateway of hope. This morning I want to pray for, we're believing for Janice's mom, Neva. She's having some health struggles. Well, Janice, I know Jesus. I know Jesus. I know Jesus. Oh, but God. Somebody else is asking for guidance, direction, and understanding, for help, and for mercy today. So let's believe the Lord for that in the name of Jesus. And Janice also is asking for prayers as she goes in for an MRI this week. She's been struggling with some other areas in her life. Well, I believe the Lord for that. Amen. We're going to continue to believe God to touch a rose in her body and just restore her to health. We believe the Lord for Deacon Diane in the name of Jesus. We believe God. We believe in the Lord. Continue for financial prosperity for Pastors Debbie and Susan. They've been faithful with little things, and now we're trusting the Lord to honor His word to make up rulers over much. Amen. There's many other needs today. I'm going to ask Pastor Chris if he would. I know Pastor Chris has been going through his own things and has a lot of stuff he's been going through, but I know Pastor Chris knows how to touch the Lord. So this morning, we're going to believe the Lord to transform your valley of weeping as well into a place of refreshing. But we should come and pray over the needs of the people today.
Hallelujah.
Father, we come before you in your mighty name. And Lord, we ask that every need, Father, your word says that when we call, that your ear is inclined to us. So, Father, every need, we address it in the mighty name of Jesus. And we declare that your miraculous power, oh God, will turn those situations now. Father, where deliverance is needed, where healing is needed, Lord, in every other situation, you are the mighty God, and you are the Prince of Peace. So we agree together, believe in you for supernatural transformations in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I don't want to put you on the spot. I know, Brother Bill, you like to slip in the background. You don't like to be seen. But I'll tell you, as I went and got my bottle of water, the Lord just gave me just a word for you. You've been at some points this week where you said, oh, I don't know if I can take much more. I don't know if I can handle any more. The Lord says, if in that moment, and there'll be more of those moments, but if in those moments you'll cast your cares on me, son, I'll carry them for you. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we're believing you, God. Strength in the name of Jesus. Supernatural strength to be able to trust in you. What joy for those whose strength comes from the Lord. So today, God, provide supernatural strength, we pray, according to the promise of your word. Watch over it now to perform it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. My goodness. I love it when the Lord comes in and messes the program up. And unto the Lamb, to Him who sits on the throne. Come on, before we change the order, come on, lift your hands in this house.
Be blessed.
been saying to the Lord, I want more of you. For every one of you that's saying that, I want you to hear the word of the Lord that said, I want more of you.
Yes, that's it. That's
the Lord says, I want more of you.
That's it.
I want more of you.
Yes.
He is longing for more of you. More of your heart, more of your life, more of your time. He wants more of you.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So I'm going to read from the word of the Lord today. Proverbs chapter 3, starting with verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding.
Yes.
In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. In another version it says, He will direct your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. Folks, that's a promise. That's a promise. And so, prepare to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. This is an opportunity. Because the Lord has made us a promise, and this is our opportunity to take Him at His word, to put our faith in action.
Thank you, Jesus.
So if I could get the ushers to come and
yes.
Send the baskets around.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, and don't start doing the math of what you can afford, and don't start doing the math. No, ask the Lord, what would you have me do? Just ask the Lord, what would you have me do?
Thank you, Father.
This our sacrifice. And in the name of Jesus, I speak to this seed.
Yes.
And I say, grow and multiply in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
You multiply to meet every need of this church, to meet every need of the kingdom. Yes, we call you kingdom seeds.
Yes.
That we reach the lost.
Yes.
That we reach the hurting. That we reach the people that are prodigal, that we reach them, that this is enough and more than enough. And I speak to this seed to multiply in the lives of the people that gave, because the word says that the Lord provides seed for the sower and bread for food. And we just call it in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, worship team. Hallelujah. You just keep playing back there. Thank you, Jesus. In just a moment, I'm going to have Pastor Susan come back, and she's going to minister the word. Hallelujah. We have a lot of things going on. One thing you may notice is we have the first candle lit on our wreath up front. It is today is the first Sunday of Advent. And we're not going to go through all the tradition like we've done in years past, but on the first Sunday of Advent, we are to remember hope. Hope. The fact that there is a Savior who was promised for thousands of years, as far back as Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. At the very beginning of creation, when man messed it all up, God came and said, I know you messed it up, but I have some hope for you. There will come one of the seed of woman who shall bruise the head of the serpent. His name in the book of Isaiah chapter 7 was to be called Emmanuel. 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 Are we on the right key? No? Well, why don't you give me the right key? Would you sing that old song with us?
For
bringing dishes and your favorite thing. I hear Rose is going to bring tamales. Hallelujah. Can we get a praise the Lord for tamales? Don't worry, I'll bring the fruitcake. So, now on a serious note, Tuesday night, Tuesday all day. What is Tuesday, y'all? It is fasting and prayer. And I will tell you, it's making a difference in this church.
Hallelujah.
It's making a difference in this church. Tuesday, throughout the day, since you did commit gluttony on Thursday, it should not be that hard. Push away the plate. Take that time that you would normally eat and stuff your body full and feast on the Word during that time.
Yes.
And then join us at 7:30 here in the sanctuary for a time of prayer as we believe the Lord for an outpouring of revival in Houston. 2015, our theme, as it is in heaven. That's what we're believing the Lord for here in Houston and a gateway of hope as we spend a day in His courts. Amen. Well, those are your Sunday morning announcements. Govern yourselves accordingly.
Yes.
New Year's Eve. Yes, that's right. New Year's Eve. We'll have another family time as we first come together for some food, some games. I know. Well, I mean, with all the fasting we're calling you to, we should also give you an opportunity to eat. And then we're going to pray out the old year and pray in the new. I can't think of a better way to ring in 2015 but in the house of the Lord. Amen. Well, let's get ready. Are you ready for His Word? Are you ready for His Word? Are you hungry for it? Well, Father, now as Your servant comes to deliver Your Word, open the bread of life to us, we pray. Anoint this vessel in the name of Jesus. Lord Jesus, let this mouth be anointed by God. Take a coal, Lord Jesus, from Your altar and touch into these lips. Lord, let the Word that You put within her now be like fire in her bones. And Jesus, let the ears of the people of God be attuned to what the Spirit is speaking in this church, we pray. And if that's your heartfelt prayer today, say amen.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
One heated by friction. Something that set off a sudden force.
Thank you, Jesus.
And when spark is used as a verb, it is to throw out sparks, to produce sparks, or to respond with enthusiasm.
Thank
now,
you, Jesus.
I want to tell you what I've figured out about sparks. Sparks die when they are removed from the source if they don't set something else on fire.
Come on.
And I could almost sit down with that one. But I'm not. Because I'm a preacher and I like to preach. Now that is a truth, but God gave me a word to speak, so I'm going to speak it. I'm going to speak from the book of Acts, chapter 2. And I want you to know, I thought that I had read this up one side and down the other and knew it sideways. And the Lord still had some more to talk to me about.
Hey.
The book of Acts, chapter 2. It's one of my favorite chapters. When the day of Pentecost came. No, stand up, stand up. This is the word. This is the word of the living God. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one accord. And suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So y'all can have a seat now. Now, I want to tell you first of all, and I'm going to do some referring back. I'm not going to make you stand up for all of the places I'm going here. In fact, I'm not going to even read directly from the Word. I'm just going to tell you a story, if that's okay. But now, the reason that they were all together in one accord on the day of Pentecost is because they were obedient.
Come on. All right. Start there.
That's where I'm starting. I never even noticed that before. But the reason they were there is because they were obedient. Now, some of them, prior to this day of Pentecost, had to repent before they could get in to the obedience. I.e., y'all remember Peter? And what he went through? But he is obedient at this point. Because you see, when we get into disobedience, that flame is not burning bright. It starts to get dim. We start to get distant. We start to try to put some separation between us and our source. Okay? That's number one. Number two, they were praying. I will tell you, prayer will start a fire. Prayer is where the first spark comes from. I'm going to tell you a little bit about prayer. Now, the first thing that you need to know about prayer is prayer in unison. When a bunch of people come together all on fire, man, you can start a wildfire real quick right there. Now, if you're praying by yourself, I want you to think about how you see the Boy Scouts starting the fire, rubbing two sticks together. Has anybody ever tried to do that?
Yeah.
Well, if you haven't tried it, I will tell you it takes some persistence. You have got to be patient. But you've got to keep rubbing, and you've got to keep rubbing, and you've got to keep rubbing till you get some sparks. And now the other thing you've got to have is something for your spark to fall on.
All right.
Oh.
Okay. Now, so we're talking about sparking.
All right.
Sparking a flame. We're talking about sparking the flame of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And I tell you, I don't want to just spark a little candle. I want to spark a wildfire.
Yes.
Are y'all ready to spark a wildfire?
Yes.
Do we want a wildfire of the Holy Ghost running through the city of Houston to spread to the rest of the nation?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Honey, we got to pray.
Hallelujah,
we have
hallelujah.
Got to pray.
Jesus,
I'll tell you,
Jesus.
Pastor Ken sparked a flame in this church.
Yes.
So he said, let's get together on Tuesday night.
Yes.
He started out just him and Pastor Chris. They started out, they came together and they started to pray. And I will tell you, then some more of us came and we started to pray. And then some more of us came and we're praying. And it's spreading into the church.
Hallelujah.
And I love the flame. I love the fire of the Holy Spirit.
Jesus.
And I want to tell you, another thing another thing, that we're in unity.
All right.
See, it's important. They were in unity. They came together in one accord. And then the Holy Spirit was poured out on all of them. Now, there were a lot more disciples of Jesus, but the first thing, they weren't obedient because they weren't there. The second thing, they weren't praying together with the rest of them in unity because they weren't there. And so therefore, they missed the outpouring of the Holy Ghost when the Holy Ghost was poured out in power.
Right.
You see, we come together and we make a flame.
Yes.
By ourselves. Look, have y'all ever, has anybody ever done barbecuing with charcoals? Mm-hmm. You ever done that?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever had one that you just kind of pulled out or seen pulled out from it, from the rest of the fire? And when you first pulled it out, it was glowing hot. It was good to go on its own. It was still glowing hot. It would still burn you if you touched it. And then the rest of them kept staying hot and burning. But then what happened to the one? It started getting dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. See, we got to get together. We cannot do this, oh, God blesses me just as much when I'm off by myself. Yes, we need some alone time with God. We also need time together. The Lord said, don't forsake assembling yourselves together for a reason. Because we make a bigger fire when we're together. And if you don't have a source, if you don't have anything that you're setting fire to, your fire is going to go out. Fire has got to have either a source that it's burning in and it's still there with it. Or, if it's separated, it's got to set something else on fire, or it's going to go out. It's going to be dim, it's going to be gray, it is going to be of no heating value. What value is that dead charcoal? That single dead charcoal?
Well, come on.
Well, come on. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I do not want to come face to face with my Lord and my God on that day and say, well, I made it through the gate. Hallelujah, I made it through the gate.
Say it.
I didn't accomplish anything down there, but I made it through the gate, Lord. I'm glad I'm here. Well, I'll be really glad to be there instead of somewhere else, but I do not want to look my Lord in the face and say, I just made it through the gate. I want to have something to lay at His feet.
That's right.
You see, all the stuff, all the junk, all the things that we place great value on, like what TV show we watched on Saturday night, that show we wanted to go to that was more important than doing what the Lord told us to do. I mean, y'all know about that. We all know about that. That's the hay and the stubble that's going to get burned up because it has no eternal value. I want to go back to that obedience thing. Y'all, the Lord expects obedience. I mean, He don't just... And the very first thing that we got to be obedient in is we have to love one another. He said, a commandment, a new commandment I give to you, that you love God first, and you love each other as I have loved you.
Yes.
That's a lot of loving. Yeah. Jesus gave His life for us.
Yes.
He said, no greater love has any man than this, that he give his life. That's a lot of love.
That's a lot of love.
It's a lot of love. And I want you to know, in the American church, we come short sometimes. We come way short sometimes. But it is a matter of obedience. You see, this church that the Holy Spirit got poured out on, and they operated in all of the power of the Holy Ghost, and the tongues of fire rested on them. Let me tell you about them. If you flip on a little further, they were operating in such a spirit of love that no one among them had any lack.
That's right.
You know? It says the ones that had extra did something so that the ones that had nothing were okay. Man.
That's good.
They loved each other. We don't do that. I don't do that. But I will tell you, the first commandment, obedience. Obedience. I mean, I want the power of God. I want to walk in the power of the kingdom. I want to walk in miracles, signs, and wonders. I am not satisfied with a theoretical Christianity. You know? I don't want to theorize about, you know, I believe the Bible's true. I read it and I think it's true. I want to know it's true because I've experienced it. And I know that it's true because the power of God is true and operating in our lives. Yo, we got to increase our love walk. And when the Lord says do something, we got to do it. You know, I'm not saying that the first thing we got to do is try to figure out what we can sell to find somebody or whatever. I'm saying when the Lord speaks to your heart, do it. Do it now, not later. Do it now. And then that's an important piece too. The ones that they thought, you know, I'll go to Jerusalem later, weren't there. You know? If I talk about later, if I say later, it might not even happen. Because those weeds grow up that Jesus talked about, that the cares of the world and my job and my this and my that and my other thing. And pretty soon I've already forgot about what the Lord said to do. We got to do it now. When the Lord says do it, we need to do it. And the other thing about obedience is that when the Lord says it, it doesn't matter if everybody thinks you're crazy. It doesn't matter if everybody thinks I'm crazy. Because sometimes when the Lord says do it, the whole world's going to think you're crazy if you do it. People were pretty sure that Debbie and I had gone off the deep end when we took off on our journey. Yeah. But I will tell you, if it was good, I wouldn't trade a minute.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Okay. We have got to be obedient to the word of the Lord, y'all. I mean, we've got some things we already know because he already put it in his word. You don't got to ask, is it God's will for me to go chasing after somebody that he's already said it's not okay to chase after?
Come on. Right?
I mean, get real. We want to ask, is it God's will for me to be with this person that he's already said not to? Can we do that in our community? Is it God's will? No, not if he already said it wasn't.
Come on.
God's not schizophrenic. He's not. I mean, I'm not saying there's anything bad about people that are, but God's not. He's not double-minded. If he said it, he meant it.
Amen.
He meant it the first time, and he still means it. Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes.
You know, ouch, hallelujah sometimes.
All right.
But if it's in the word, he meant it.
Amen. Come on.
Still does.
Come on.
Don't got to question. You don't got to seek. You don't got to cry out and ponder all that, you know. If he said it's wrong here, it's still wrong
there.
Right. You know? I don't have to ask the Lord when I see somebody else's money laying on the table if it's his will to take it. You know? I don't have to ask that question. I already know. No, it's not mine. It's theirs, so I better leave it alone. And it doesn't matter if I'm broke and they're not. You know? It's just simple. That's some simple stuff, you know. We got those 10 commandments, you know, that non-adultery thing that we try to ignore because it's in our community.
Oh, you let him tell that.
I went there, yeah, because God said it. He didn't change the rules. He didn't make the gay gospel.
Hallelujah.
There is not a separate one. Man, if...
That is it.
Come on.
It's wrong, and only if it isn't already in the Word do we need to ask God what's your will.
That's right.
You can ask God, Lord, is this the job you have for me? Because He doesn't say, Cheryl, take the job down there at Albertson's today. And that's not in the Word. So if Cheryl's contemplating a job change, she might want to ask Him. He'll tell us. He's good like that.
Yes, He is.
Oh, I'm going to tell you something else about obedience. Just because it's uncomfortable does not mean it's not God's will. We have made our comfort in the United States of America, we have made it an idol.
That's right, we have.
That's another area we just got to get out of. Because if we want the fire of the Holy Ghost, we've got to be obedient.
Yes.
And those apostles in the Bible were greatly uncomfortable sometimes. You know, I cannot find anything that looks like comfort in the definition of getting stoned in the biblical sense. I cannot find anything that looks comfortable about that. I can't find anything that sounds comfortable about those prisons that they got put in back there. You know? And then we start thinking when it gets uncomfortable, when people, the people might laugh at me. No, that's not God's will. They'll think I'm crazy. They'll call me a fanatic. Well, honey, let me tell you something. Getting called a fanatic is not being persecuted.
Amen. Come on.
Amen.
Being called a fanatic means that someone had a word that was not complimentary towards you, and you decided to be upset and disturbed about it. Actually, we should be considering getting called a fanatic for Jesus a compliment. We should. Because the most important thing is a thing with an eternal consequence. I'm going to tell you something else. Ain't nobody getting scared into the kingdom. Ain't nobody being condemned into the kingdom. Jesus says love. We love people into the kingdom.
Yes.
We love them into the kingdom, and we love them, and we love them, and we love them. And if they don't know how to act when they get into the kingdom, we pray for them. And we pray for them some more, and we pray for them some more, and we keep praying for them, and we keep loving them. And that's what we do. Because that's what we're commanded to do. Bless God. I'm getting stuck here, man. I had no idea I was going to talk about all this, but I asked God to speak. So praise the Lord. And we have got to be persistent. You know, I will tell you that when they went to praying in the Bible, they didn't pray a 5-minute prayer, and if it didn't get answered, they called it done. That was not the way it worked then, and that's not the way it works now. If we want fire, we have got to pray, and we have got to pray, and we have to pray until we get the breakthrough. We're sparking the flame here. This is just about the spark. I dread to hear what Debbie's going to tell us. But I'm sparking the fire. Because I want a wildfire.
Yes.
The Lord started speaking the word wildfire when we were here on Tuesday night. He said, fire on the mountain of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. I want the fire. Fire! 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 Kingdom fire. You know, we've been complacent. We've been apathetic. We've been content to have church as usual. We've been content to come and warm up our seat and go home and say, oh, that was good. But if it doesn't change anything, it wasn't worth the time. We have got to have our hearts and our lives changed by an encounter with God. And that's what it's all about. about being changed. It's not about staying where we were. And if I'm stirring your grits real hard, you don't have to wait till the altar call.
Hey, come on out.
You know, get it straightened out with God right now so you can listen to the rest of the message without being uncomfortable. You know, just go ahead, it's real easy, you know. Get real with God. You don't have to tell me all about what you did or didn't do. It's all about what you're talking about with Him. He's the one. See, I have the thought that a lot of us are like the angel, you know, the angel of the church of Ephesus got the word. These are the words of Him who holds the seven stars in His right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, your perseverance, and all that was good. You've persevered, you've endured, you haven't grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you've fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. That's an ouch hallelujah now, isn't it? They were still doing the stuff. They hadn't quit. You've left your first love. You see, in the first love, you can't wait to spend time with your first love. Remember that? Anybody ever been in love? I mean, seriously in love? And you just, oh man, you're hanging on every word. You're getting dressed and, will she like this one? Oh, her eyes. You think about her eyes when you're supposed to be cooking dinner. You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yes.
Anybody
yes.
ever been in love? Yes. Remember when you were first saved? How you thought about Jesus when you woke up in the morning?
Jesus.
How we wanted to please Him all day long. And then, we got busy. Sometimes we even got busy doing the work of the ministry. And we got so busy doing the work, we forgot who we were doing the work for.
Come on.
If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. Now, do I believe that means that, if you don't repent, you're going to not make it to heaven? No, I don't believe that. I think that means that you're going to lose your reward.
Yes.
It means that your work will not stand if you don't do it from the place of love that you need to.
Yeah.
Of being absolutely in love with Him. The Lord says, I want more of you. We sing and we dance and we cry out, I want more of you, I want more of you. But we don't want to give Him more of us. We say anything but that, Lord.
Well,
I don't know what your that is. But if He asks, give it. That's all I can say. If He asks, give it. Give it now. Do it now. Don't wait. If you wait, you'll decide, I'll look silly. I ain't doing that. If you wait, somebody will talk you out of it because they'll tell you, the Lord doesn't say that. You know? Don't wait. Just do it. Do it now. That's a word for somebody.
Amen.
That is a word for somebody. Do it now. Jeez. The Lord's been speaking. Don't wait. Don't put it off. You heard right. Do it now. And I'm also going to talk about the church in Laodicea. You see, the Lord says, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. Because you are lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I'm about to spit you out. You say, I'm rich, I've acquired wealth, and don't need anything. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked.
Jeez.
I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so that you can become rich. Rich in the kingdom.
Yes.
Rich in the word.
Yes.
Rich in what God wants to do in your life.
Yes.
And white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness. Salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Because those who I love, I rebuke and discipline. Be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Y'all, that's talking to the Christians.
Yes.
The Lord Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. Does anybody hear my voice?
Jesus.
Does anybody hear his voice when he stands at the door and knocks?
Jesus.
If anybody hears him, open the door.
Yes.
No, keep the heart open to him. What is he speaking to you? We are going to have some classes within this church on how to hear and know you've heard from the Lord for those that haven't learned to recognize his voice yet. It's so important. It's so important. But I will tell you just a hint right now. If it's loving, if it's kind, if it's good, it's not your flesh. And if it's radically kingdom-oriented, it is certainly not your flesh, and you haven't lost your mind. Just do it. Just
okay.
Do it.
Yeah.
See, we want to keep the fire burning.
Yes, ma'am.
See, that spark. You need to spark the flame. See, in Acts chapter 2, their obedience, their prayer, their unity, and their persistence, they set a spark in place. So the Holy Spirit came and rested on each of them like a tongue of fire. And it was a fire that spread like wildfire. It is not a crazy thought to say we can have that today.
That's right.
We can have that today. This people, the people in this house right now, can have that. That this is that was prophesied about in the book of Joel. We can. And we can walk in the miracles, the signs, and the wonders that the Lord Jesus Christ said will follow those who believe. Now, he did not say that miracles, signs, and wonders will follow you if you sit in the chair.
Okay.
He said they will follow you.
Yes. Yes.
But you see, we have to believe. We have to take him at his word. And I can speak to this from experience. I'm not talking about a theory. Have I hit the point and have I had to come and be obedient and repent from stuff that I had to repent of? Have I been in the place where I got separated from my source and my love got cold and I had to repent and bring it back? Yes, I have. I'm not talking about a theory. I'm talking about things that happen here. And Pastor Ken is going to come up and he's going to play and I'm going to invite you to come up. The altar is open. You know, if there's something that you haven't been obedient about, please get it straightened out.
Yes.
Don't stay there in a cold spot.
Yes.
You know? And if you need personal prayer, the prayer team will be up here, but don't feel like it's about what you're doing with God. This is about a personal conversation for you to have at the altar. You know, leave it at the altar. It's important stuff.
That's right. That's right.
It's important stuff, y'all. So Pastor Ken's going to come up. The altar is open. I'm inviting you to look deep. Look deep. Is there anything that you can lay at his feet? Is there anybody that you have a grudge against. Is there anybody that you feel like, you know, I don't want to hang with them? Part of your church family? They were commanded to love. This is a call, y'all.
That's right.
This is a call to change. This is a call to become people of God. I want to start a spark. I want to start a wildfire. Y'all be about it.
Dealing with you, and he says, I want you to come back to your first love today.
Maybe you haven't darkened the church house door in years, and maybe you've never been there. Maybe I'm speaking to somebody on that camera right now who's watching on the video. Today, the Spirit of God is calling you. In this room, somebody is being called by God. And he's saying, I want you to surrender your life to me today. It's not about joining a church. It's not about becoming part of a religion. But it's all about today surrendering. We're going to sing this one more time. And if that's you, would you come? Would you move to that aisle? Or would you just find your way to this altar? And would you say, Jesus, I surrender. I surrender my sin. I surrender my life. I surrender those things that I've been holding on to. I surrender today. He's waiting on you. All to be my blessed Savior. I surrender. Oh, we're going to sing it again. I surrender all. I surrender all. I surrender. Come on, let hope be born. For this word that has been brought. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are yet desirous of sparking a flame within our hearts and within our lives. And Jesus, today we ask you now, God, as we prepare to leave this place, God, as we prepare to go from here, that you would watch over us, that you would be with us, but more importantly, that you would watch over the word which has been deposited in our hearts. God, that you would honor the promise of Scripture, that you watch over your word in order to perform it. Lord Jesus, we know that now this word is going to go forward. And it will not come back to you empty, but it will accomplish, Lord Jesus, everything, Lord, everything, Father, that has been sent forward to do. Now, in the name of Jesus, I set your angels round about this word. We draw a bloodline around it and we say, Satan, you cannot approach this word. You cannot steal this word. But rather, this word will be planted down deep within the hearts of your people. That this people shall be rooted and grounded and established and firm in the word which was delivered today. Lord, spark, Lord Jesus, a flame, Lord. A raging fire, we pray in the name of Jesus. In our hearts, in our lives, in Jesus' name. And so now I declare with this people, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Say it with me, our worship is not over. Our service is just beginning. Go and be the people of God. Amen.
Thank you for taking the time to watch this video of one of our worship services, A Gateway of Hope. At Gateway of Hope, we exist for one simple reason, and that is to connect real people to a real God in a real way. If that has happened to you while watching this video, please let us know by sending us an email at contactus@gatewayhouston.org. We'd love to meet you in person. We meet Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. at 9511 Town Park Drive in Houston. Directions to our worship center can be found on our website at gatewayhouston.org. Until we see you again, remember, our worship is not over. Our service is just beginning. Let's go and be the people of God.